I want to tell you guys a story today, a story that might sound like it's tools and techniques, what I call carpentry work, how we swing the hammer. But what I've found, I'm always looking for greater meaning in the stuff that I'm working on with my team. And I found this interesting way of discovering new connections between things. So this idea of connected UX, the story that I want to tell you today, is the tools get us there, but it's ultimately about connecting people together. So I've been at MailChimp for a long time. I was number four. I was the fourth employee. And it used to be it was just me and our lead engineer. We were working on the app. We rewrote every line of code and redesigned every screen. And we were just, you know, trying to make do with the resources we had. And we did a lot of guessing, what I call a lot of shooting from the hip. So we would make features, we would build out a UI, and we would assume, this is the right way to build this. This seems easy, the easiest way to do this. And this is the thing that's most relevant to people's workflow. But it was really just guessing, and that was it. And I remember at the very beginning when it was just me doing, you know, front-end development. I was writing HTML and CSS. I was designing screens and doing all of that stuff. I didn't have time to do any kind of research. But to me, that was the pinnacle. That was what I was shooting for, was that at some point, we wouldn't be shooting from the hip anymore. We wouldn't be guessing. We would actually be able to do some kind of concrete research. We'd be able to talk to customers more often, do usability testing, that sort of thing. So the company grew. We hired some folks. And finally, we started to be able to build some prototypes and you know, be able to test those with folks. We met with customers a lot and learned so much. It's one of my favorite things to do is to talk to customers and listen to them, how their business works and how they do things. Because that helps me make things that are more relevant to them. You know, I started to be able to do some basic usability testing. And I'm a big fan of doing it the MacGyver way, just bubblegum and duct tape. What's the cheap and easy way to do this, that I can do this quickly, get a little bit smarter, and make a better product very quickly? So we did some usability testing, but not with a fancy lab or anything. I still don't have a fancy lab. I started to collect customer feedback with a form on the website. You know, customer feedback would come in, and I'd read that, and I'd learn a lot from that. It wasn't always something that I could, you know, it wasn't actionable that I could do something with, but it was still something that helped me understand where our customers were coming from. And eventually, we started to set up different analytics packages that would tell us, you know, these are the common pathways. These are where these are the places where people are struggling and tripping. So all of this was very useful and helpful stuff, great exercises. And before we knew it, we started out having no data and shooting from the hip to having a lot of data. So much data that it became a bit of an overload, where it was just so much information for us to process. And it would make us a little bit smarter, and we'd make something that was a little bit easier to use, a little bit more relevant to people's workflow and their lives. But we would get smarter, and then we'd get dumber. We'd learn something, and then we'd lose it. So we would gain these insights in a very focused study. Let's study a particular type of user. Let's study a particular workflow or a particular feature. We'd learn something there. Well, oftentimes, that would coalesce into some kind of a report that we'd share with a lot of people. And we'd make something a little bit better. And then we'd forget that we had done that, because it was just so much information to keep track of. So that became a big problem. And I started to see every once in a while we'd replicate our efforts. We would redouble our efforts, that we already studied that, and then we'd end up studying it again because things are changed, or we just lost track of that information. The information might languish in obscurity in someone's hard drive. So the more I saw that happening, I started to see we could gather data. We had that in spades. And we could look at that data really closely, and we could turn that into information. I see this is what's happening. These are the patterns emerging here. And then we could turn that into knowledge, temporary knowledge, where we would say, we see these problems. We propose this is how we'll fix them. This, let's go make this a better product. But rarely, rarely would we be able to turn that into real wisdom. I saw that for us, for our team, what we were struggling with, trying to figure this out. And I see this in a lot of companies. I talk to different startups and all sorts of different UX teams. And so few of them figure out a way to take all that information, connect all of that stuff together, keep it, and start to see the relationships between seemingly unconnected, disconnected things. Rarely do they get to that point where they have wisdom. I see the problem. I know what to do about it. I know why this is happening. I see what's going to happen in the future. I can see a trajectory that we're on and what our customers are doing. Having that wisdom to find out what's coming next, it's called strategy. You know, it's like going from being very tactical, studying things, always looking in the microscope, looking at something very closely, making some adjustments, but never looking up, never seeing the landscape of how this all fits together. And that's what strategy is about. And so much of user experience research, that learning, is about tactics. It's about tactics. It's, I will do a usability test on this thing, and I will shave off 2 seconds from this workflow. That is satisfying work. I like doing that. It makes me feel like I saved someone some time in their life, and they can go, you know, to the playground with their kids. That's cool. That's good. But only doing that, you never make interfaces all that much better and smarter. You can never make these giant leaps. So strategy is a core thing, such an important thing for a company to be smarter, to leap forward from, you know, a leap in front of its competitors, and create new things that help its customers solve problems better. So what I saw in my team, and what I see in the user experience discipline in general, is we've got research down to a science. It's called user science. We study customers very well. We have all of these techniques. We have the tactics, and we're damn good at it. But rarely do we connect all of this stuff together, all of these disconnected things. We leave data and information, valuable stuff on the table. That's in another team. The team holds control of that stuff, and they don't let other teams come in and look at that and compare notes. So we need connections. When a company starts to scale, get to a certain size, we need connections between this information, and ultimately we need connections between the people that are the stewards of that information. I want to tell you a story of a little crisis, a little panic moment that I had. I had a bit of a freak out about a year ago where I had all of this information coming in, and my inbox looked a little bit like this. It just kept exploding, and emails were coming in with customer feedback, which was cool. People were really excited about the product, but my inbox, you know, it's just like this infinity symbol. It just stopped tracking numbers. It was just inbox infinity. And I was stressed out by it, freaked out by it. I just couldn't get through my email fast enough. And although it's good information that helped me understand what we could do better, I couldn't really adjust our roadmap for all of these things. It just didn't make a lot of sense. And I'd have to see, like, is there critical mass on this issue that, you know, warrants shifting our resources? So about that time, Merlin Mann was visiting and talking and hanging out with us. And Merlin knows a little bit about managing your inbox and lots of email. So I told him, you know, I've got all of this customer feedback that's good coming in, you know, from a WooFoo form on our website, but I don't want to just turn it off because that's really, you know, what does that say to our customers? We don't want to listen to you anymore. It's just too much information. And so Merlin, in his infinite wisdom, said, you know, burn that shit down. Just chuck it out. It's if you can't process that information, it is not worth your time. It's not worth the stress. Burn it down, back to inbox zero, focus on what you can do today. And though I heard the wisdom in what he was saying, my gut, as the lead of a user experience team, making a product for millions of people, I just felt like I would not be a very good person. I would not be very good at my job if I did that. I need to do something with that. So instead, I decided, okay, maybe if I just, you know, cleaned off my desk, I just pushed all this stuff into a different place, I don't know what I'm going to do with it, but I could just go put it in a bucket somewhere, and then later I could maybe find something to do with that. So, you know, I wanted a database of some sort. We had experimented with all these wikis in the past to collect information, and it was very cumbersome and difficult. So instead of burning it down, I just decided, all right, I'm going to funnel this stuff into Evernote. Why did I choose Evernote? Because it was cheap. I just got set up a free account, and I could just email this stuff in. So I set up a Gmail script. Anytime an email with this subject line comes in, and it's starred, if I read through it and I starred it, that means this is worthy of attention later. This is the cream. The other stuff that's not starred, it may be a red herring. So if it's starred and it has this subject line, I want you to send it to this email address that will drop it into Evernote, and it puts it in a specific notebook for me. All right, cool. So I found a way to clear my inbox on a regular basis, collect this stuff. Maybe I can do something with it later. You know, I had a few hundred pieces of information at that point. And what was interesting was the feedback form asked for an email address. So I had information. I curated that, you know, skimmed off the cream, and all of that feedback had an email address. So if I ever needed to get in touch with that person that gave me that feedback, I had an easy way to get in touch with them. Again, still don't know what I'm going to do with this. So Ben Chestnut, who's our CEO, he sent an email, and we were working on some automation stuff, email automation stuff, these features, and he said, you know, we've done a lot of research around this, but I'm curious. We don't have a ton of time before the release, but do you have any information if people talked about this one particular feature? It's called RSS to email. It's just, you know, you put it on your, put a sign-up form on your blog, and it'll email when you publish something on your blog, email your subscribers that information. So he wondered, like, what do people struggle with that particular feature? And so I was just curious, like, okay, maybe I could go look this up in my little database here. So I did a quick search. For RSS, and that search turned up about 45 pieces of feedback. Not a huge number of feedback, but that was actually what was cool about this was it was good feedback. It was really good, relevant, insightful feedback where someone took the time to say, this is exactly what I'm struggling with, where you guys fall short. And I compiled all that stuff together, and I started to see of the 45 pieces of feedback, with email addresses attached, where I could, you know, get in touch with that person, I started to see some patterns emerge. So Ben sent me this email on a Friday afternoon. It was around maybe 2:30 or something in the afternoon. Sitting there with my cup of coffee, do a quick search, start to find these patterns, shoot out a few emails to a few of these people to ask for clarification or more background info. Got that in relatively quick. And then by Monday morning, I had a pretty good, a solid recommendation of, okay, well, here are the things that people are struggling with. So we built that stuff. We built that in a week's time, and we launched it the following week. And it was a big deal. People really liked it and you know, appreciated that we were listening so carefully. And it was one of those, like, OMG moments where a light bulb just went off that I've got a nice little chunk of information, but I wish I had a whole lot more. What other types of information could I put in here that I could cross-reference and connect? Because we had more stuff. Surely we can connect all of this stuff together in different ways. So I started talking to people. I started talking to other people in my team because that was the low-hanging fruit. So I talked to Greg. Greg is a design researcher, and he works closely with another guy named Fernando. And these two guys, they do a lot of interviews. They, you know, collect a lot of this customer feedback, and they had a fair bit of data. So I just said, can you guys start funneling that stuff in as well? Create a new notebook, and let's start funneling that in. So we had the customer feedback, and we also started collecting the surveys. When someone closes an account, we ask them a few questions about why you left. You can learn a lot about why someone signs up, about your customers in general, of, you know, asking them questions about why they signed up and then why they left. That'll give you tons of insight about what you can improve. So our database got a little bit richer with different types of information, but it's still itty-bitty. I talked to Jen, who's another design researcher. She does a lot of usability testing and customer interviews. And I talked to Steph, who also does a lot of customer interviews with lots of folks around the world. They had additional stuff. They had transcripts from previous interviews, and you know, it was about 45 interviews that we had in there, and it was a lot of information. It's like the full transcript. So we would record these interviews, and then we would use something like Casting Words to have them transcribe all of that. And then we'd take that text and put it in here. So transcripts from 45 full interviews that sometimes are 30, 40 minutes long. A lot of rich information that's in that. So it starts to get a little bit richer. And I get another email from Ben. And he says, you know, I've been reading, you know, he's getting these customer feedback emails in his inbox too. And he's said, you know, I've been reading through some of these and it feels like maybe there's a trend or something about people that want to like embed a video in their email, which you can't really actually do that, but they just basically want like a poster image with a play button on it. You click and it takes you to a YouTube page. And he said, you know, is this a thing? Are there a lot of people asking about this stuff, or is this just some kind of weird anomaly? So we did another search. This time Greg did the search. And he sent Ben an email and he said, 11. And Ben said, 11, what is that? 11 people have mentioned that they want to embed a video or do something like what you're describing. It's 11 is the answer in the past 3 months. So what was, you know, some customer feedback? It was mostly qualitative information, mentioned a couple places like in an interview here and there. We could turn that into quantitative information. We could say it's this big, and out of the breadth of the data that we have here over this, you know, sample time, it's only 11. So that says it's not a huge deal here. So the previous example, it was here's how we can act and do something. This is here's what we're not going to do. That's not worth our time right now because this is not a big deal. It's a small deal that a few people are asking about. And that was yet another just like, wow, if we can have these different types of information connected and we can learn what we can and we can't do, what can we do if we put more in there? So our team had collected all of our stuff at this point into this database, and the next step was to start talking to other teams that have a lot of information, like this guy, John, who is a data scientist. He's really smart. He does all kinds of data manipulation on, you know, metric shit tons of data. Lots of different stuff that he's manipulating with these queries and stuff, and he has some aggregate findings that he could share. And he started to funnel that into the database as well. I talked to Matthew, who works in the delivery group that checks to make sure that emails are being delivered into various systems and ISPs around the world. And he has tons of information about how many emails we're sending and how the volume changes over time. And we get a sense for customer behaviors from that data. I talked to Brad, who is a bit of a data nerd himself, working in support, and he looks at all support transcripts, all emails coming in asking for support, and he can find patterns that say this topic is being talked about a lot from all of our customers this week. There must be something weird with the release, or something has popped up in the app that is causing a lot of support problems. So valuable information that helps us get smarter. I talked to Allison, who is in the engineering team, and she does a lot of analytics stuff. Stuff with databases and finding patterns in the databases, but also with Google Analytics and various other things as well. Also relevant stuff. And I talked to Amanda, who monitors our blog comments. She monitors tweets and Facebook posts, all kinds of social conversation around MailChimp. She had tons of information as well. And I talked to Eric, who's the lead engineer on MailChimp, and he had a whole bunch of information, and he said, you know, I could just set up some scripts that will pull common pathway activities of what types of email templates people are using, how long it takes them to get from point A to point B, you know, what sort of industry breakdown we have for all these different customers and behaviors for different industries. So he set up these scripts and then set up cron jobs to run, go to the databases, run these big queries, and then dump them as emails into the database, into another notebook, so we could see this aggregate behavior. So we're starting to get broad understandings of what are all customers doing and what are individual customers doing. All this stuff started coming in one way or another, and we created streams. So whereas before, what my team was doing, it's like, we did an interview, take the transcript, paste it in here. You know, it's basically like manually moving things over. It's very note-taking-ish approach. But what these guys were doing, it was streaming. So Amanda would curate specific social comments, and that stuff would then be collected and streamed into the database. What Eric was doing was also, it's not like he's manually culling through, you know, going through a bunch of data. It's just streaming in. So all these people have these streams. Allison, in Google Analytics, you can set up a cron job as well. Basically, like every Monday morning, I'd like a report on how people use mobile devices on this website. What's the breakdown? What's the breakdown on countries and so forth? And send it to this email address. So those PDFs come in, streamed in every morning as well, and we can see how that stuff goes up and down through time, which is really fascinating. So all these streams coming in, and we're starting to connect these different things. So we had these account closing surveys that came in from WooFoo. We had blog comments. We had the various analytics from this automated stuff we did with Google Analytics. We had news about what's happening with various competitors. We use Google Alerts, search for a keyword, and then it emails to Evernote into a specific notebook so we can see what's going on through time. We have stats about how emails are being delivered and when there are spikes at different seasons, understand kind of an aggregate user behavior. We had industry research, so we use the little Evernote Clipper thing that's in your browser, and you find an interesting piece of information, an interesting article about, you know, how people are using Android devices, let's say. You clip that, and it goes right into industry research. So we've got another dimension, a very broad dimension of what's happening in the technology sector, what's happening with competitors, what's happening with our company, what's happening down to individual users. And then every time we have a release, the support team writes a full list of, these are all the things that are changing. And they send an email out to the whole company. And we just BCC the Evernote account too. So that goes into a notebook so we can see, this is what we did over the past year. These are the things that changed. So if you start to see a spike in one support issue, you could say, all right, it came from probably something we did in this release over here. And then, of course, we had support data, like aggregate transcripts about different topics that was streaming in as well, plus aggregate data about, you know, just trends. And then survey data. Oh, man, I'm not ashamed to admit that I love surveys so much because you just learn a ton from your customers. So if you run a survey with something like SurveyMonkey, you ask some questions, and then you can pivot and kind of filter based on how people answer different questions. And you could take a screenshot of a chart of what people said was the most important feature. Why did they sign up for your service? What mobile devices did they use? How do they do particular things in your app? You screenshot that and you paste it into Evernote, and it's got OCR. So when you search and Android's in a screenshot, the word Android is in a screenshot, it'll find that chart for you and show it to you. Tweets were coming in as well, and this is not all like, you're awesome tweets, because you don't really learn anything from that. These were, you guys suck, and here's why you suck. Here's what I'm struggling with. Those sorts of things, we would curate and stream those in as well. So all of these different disconnected things that my research team was not privy to. We didn't have access to it, not because there was any political infighting or anything. It was just that, to be honest, it didn't really occur to us that we should be looking at all of these different things as part of the same story. So all of these things stream into one big bucket. Big, gloriously unstructured, blobby bucket of stuff. And you can do a search, and you start to find things cross-silo between these different dimensions. And you can filter further down on that, too. So what started as just a couple notebooks became dozens and dozens and dozens of notebooks. Gigabytes of data, lots and lots of data that we could filter through. And what was really interesting to me is that although it started as this is the user experience team's project, it quickly, very quickly shifted to be shared ownership. This is all of our stuff. We all own this. We're all responsible for this information. We all make sure that good stuff goes in, because if there's crappy stuff, that starts to erode people's trust in the database of insights here. And in doing that, in getting people together, people are dumping things in, we discovered this really important core principle of connected UX, that you've got to have data for everyone and everyone's data for this to work. Data for everyone and everyone's data. Everyone has the opportunity to contribute. Everyone has the opportunity to dig through. It's open, it's easy, it's accessible. I mentioned that we used wikis in the past. I feel like wikis are just meant to frustrate and confuse people. And any sort of barrier to participation prevents people from actually going there and having a sense of trust that this is where the answers lie. I can go look over here. So data for everyone and everyone's data made a situation where people started to ask lots of questions they weren't asking before, exploring this stuff. And they might just be lurking and looking at what's in there and eventually find a way to contribute. But you don't have to feel the pressure of, I have to contribute as well. You know, we've got plenty of contributors already. So this was a big win. It's a big win not only in what we can learn and how fast we can learn it, how we can go from tactical to strategic thinking. But it's also a big win when you have data for everyone and everyone's data. Think about the political implications. Think about the collaborative implications. You get people that are more aware of what their colleagues are doing in a spirit of sharing. I see what you're doing. That's really interesting and relevant to what I'm doing. I want to be able to share that stuff with you. Have you thought about this? So that was a big win too, just in how it shaped our team's behavior. And then we started doing stuff like this almost immediately after people started dumping things in. Data nerd lunches. So people that are super nerdy about data had something interesting that they were studying and they want to tell other people about it. So we would just, you know, buy some nice lunch, say, you know, let's go meet in a conference room and let's chat. And we started to share lots of ideas. And this started happening where you'd get ideas exchanged from, you know, data scientists and engineers and user experience designers and researchers. And all of this was a fluid exchange of information. It wasn't like, let's set a specific time and meeting and you know, to always share this stuff. Well, we had that going on. But once you get into that habit of sharing what you're working on, everyone wants to share that. Everyone wants to tell you what they're doing and how we can make things better. So that was really cool, a really amazing win. We started to connect the data, and in doing so, we started connecting people. Here's how we did this. Some of the nuts and bolts, the mechanics of this, the plumbing. What I like about this approach, and in this example, the story that I'm telling you, it's not to suggest there aren't other ways to do this. I have seen other people use things like WordPress, you know, any number of tools out there that could solve this problem. This worked for us. Your mileage may vary. But the thing that I found great about this approach is that there wasn't a big learning curve for how do I contribute and how do I consume information. And the way that you contribute was so easy. It's email. Email is the API. Do you have something valuable to share? You are in your inbox. You can write something. You can copy and paste something. You can set up your own stream to stream in new data and just send it to this secret email address that we share just only internally with the company. Email is the API. There's no additional workflow that you have to learn. You already know how to send an email. So that meant that a lot of people that were started contributing who were not developers, they, you know, aren't writing code, you know, designers can contribute, support folks can contribute. Hell, accountants are contributing. It's pretty fascinating. So email is the API, and because it's so simple to do, we discovered this new principle. It's got to be easy in and easy out. And like I said, if there are any barriers to discovering things, any barriers to contributing, people won't contribute. They won't take part. So it's got to be easy. And it's not surprising because the products that we make, we have to make them usable. So the workflows, when we work in a very busy environment, we also have to make those things very usable as well. how we funnel things, in the subject line of an email, you just add at and the name of a notebook, at analytics, and it'll go into that notebook. At, I don't know, customer feedback, and it'll go into that notebook. So Evernote has an email parser. They just see that incoming email, and they parse that for you. All this data that's coming in is very unstructured, and that's a beautiful thing because it makes it easy to contribute. It makes it potentially problematic, though, because how do you find the connections when there are synonyms and, you know, different words that are related but not necessarily visible through a keyword search? Well, we deal with that by tagging. And in the email subject line, you can just add a hashtag, just like if you're writing a tweet, and you can tag it with a particular subject. A particular piece of metadata. So it's easy to find. So we now have, you know, just tons of tags, and every once in a while we have to go in and look at these tags, group things, clean stuff out, delete things, and so forth. But what you get is a lovely way to just browse different topics. I see there's, you know, 24 pieces of data about account closing problems or credit card processing or whatever that is. So you can go in and look at that particular piece of information, you know, that particular topic, see if there are patterns there. It's a lovely way to find patterns that you might not be looking for. The process is simple. We do a quick search, you know, like we did with the RSS example. You search for something. You take all of that information. You find all of these different things. So in this example, I was researching mobile usage. And I was researching Android specifically. How do our customers and how do people in the world use Android devices? So I did a quick search, and here's what I found. I found a couple interviews with customers. One guy I talked to in Georgia, one guy I talked to in California, photos, and tells all about their workplace and their workflow. I found lots of industry news. Some stuff from Luke Rabluski's blog. That's why he goes by Luke W. Stuff from Engadget, all kinds of different places that had stats about how people use Android. I found some additional research that someone had contributed that from industry-related sources. I found specific feedback from customers where they said, I'm using an Android device. Here's where I think you guys could get better. I found tweets where people particularly, you know, specifically mentioned Android. I found statistics from surveys that we had run. Earlier in the year, we do a big annual survey that helped us discover that stuff. I found analytics about a browser breakdown and, you know, what people are actually doing with their mobile devices on our product site and in the app. I found all kinds of disconnected, all these different, beautiful, different things here. And even notes from a release. Release 8.0 had an Android update. All these different things start to give me a good picture of how does the world use Android devices? How do our customers use Android devices? How do specific people use Android devices and maybe struggle with things? That's a very interesting way to get closer, go from data to information to knowledge about this topic, and ultimately to wisdom. When you do a search, the next thing we usually do is we stage that up in some way. If it's feedback that we're digging through, we, you know, stage it up in maybe a spreadsheet in Google Docs or something. We start to organize and categorize and tag that stuff. We collect email addresses. We do follow-up interviews with people so we can collect additional information, which we then funnel back into the database so other people might be able to discover that in the future or, you know, at the same time. We stage all of that stuff up and we work collaboratively. And that makes it faster to go through these studies. We've got all this data here. We're working collaboratively. We're dividing and conquering. And that ultimately turns into a document where we can, you know, create a report and say, here's a strategy based on this study we've been doing. All the stuff that we looked at in our existing data, all these people we talked to, all the usability tests we might have done around this, and here's a strategy that we can follow going forward. So that's great for known searches, but it doesn't always work that way where you know exactly the questions to ask. It often happens. We have specific things we start to hear and you see patterns. But what do you do when there's an unknown search? When you want to discover something that you might not be looking for? Well, it turns out when you have access to information in lots of different places, mobile first idea, ring a bell. When you have access to it and you're standing in the grocery store line and you're waiting and you can pull out your phone and you can open up an app and do a quick search or see what your colleagues are contributing, the new things that have been coming in, you start to learn things that you weren't looking to learn. You start to just discover what is interesting, what's relevant, what's coming in. So having your data available on all these devices, not only making it open to all the people, but then having it easily accessible, also makes it easier to get smarter as an individual contributor and as a team and as a company. We call it passive learning, where we just have access to this. It's always around. We can always, you know, discover and dig through, and I get notifications of, Greg just contributed 3 new notes about blah, and then I go look at that thing. So passive learning. Another thing that we discovered once we had all of this information in these big buckets is that we did a big project. We did a personas project. We talked to dozens of customers around the world. We did a lot of traveling, a lot of calls, a lot of screen sharing. And we created a series of personas that help us understand these are the archetypes of our customers. The more people you talk to, the more you start to see patterns. People are, you know, in these different categories, these different archetypes. They are motivated by these common things. They're attracted to these common things. And we turned that information into a series of posters. So now we know about Fred, our ideal user. We know about Eliza, our PR manager, who's busy and might be inefficient, but she's smart. She knows how to communicate. She's very educated and social. We know about the studio consultant, Mario, who is generally self-reliant. He's a problem solver. He's very creative. He's savvy. He's a manager. We know about Andre, who's the developer. He's the technology savant. He's very techie, also educated, but often self-serving. And we took these posters and we put them up in our common space, so it creates a common language of discussion of, this is something we're working on, but I think Mario's going to really struggle with this. Or, you know, we did a big redesign and made the whole app responsive, and we knew that Ada's would, you know, would struggle with that because they don't like to relearn new interfaces. So that helped us understand, you know, as a company, how do we talk about our customers? We took that information, we took this big database, we did all these interviews with people, and when we interview people, we can pretty much tell, are they an Ada? Are they an Eliza? Are they a Mario? So we started to tag them in the database. And when we tag them, we can start to do searches of, how do people use Android? How do Adas use Android devices? So you've got an additional dimension for understanding and doing searches to understand how your customers behave. Really fascinating stuff. The more we started to do this, we studied these personas more, and we started to see common traits. Adas use these features. They do these things over time. So then we can look specifically, like, let's automate this and look at all of these common traits that this is probably an Ada, this is probably an Eliza. We can start to see these traits and behaviors with app usage without even doing an interview. Of course, you can do a follow-up interview to verify some of that stuff. But then you can really start to drill down into specific behaviors and motivations. But we found having access to all of this data, data for everyone and everyone's data, it's easy in and easy out, it's mobily accessible, so anyone can look at any time. All powerful and important, but when it comes down to it, data is not going to transform itself into wisdom. You have to do that yourself. Wisdom comes from telling stories. So we took a lot of this information, and we do this on a regular basis, and we turn it into some kind of a story that we can share with the team. So, you know, we've got these giant documents, a document, a report that might end up being 40 pages long. And, you know, I'm not... I'm not a fool. I know this is not exactly sitting on someone's nightstand as nighttime reading, right? We'd definitely put you to sleep, though, if you had insomnia. So only a few people are really going to sit and read through 40 pages of findings. But I found that when we partnered with our video guy, Josh Rosenbaum, we could turn a lot of these reports into short video clips. Maybe it's a two-minute-long video clip. So earlier this year, when we were studying the way that people use mobile devices, and we discovered it wasn't just about using mobile devices, it's about extending the work day into different places, that the work day occurs in lots of different places, and it just doesn't stop. And because it doesn't stop, we just keep filling it up with more things to do. And because there's more things to do, we have to hand these tasks off to different people in our team. So it's always moving forward. And that helped us understand how to design new mobile apps, how to design a new app that would be responsive, that would work and go wherever you go. And that all came from studying, researching the way that I'm describing here, turning that into a report, and then making that into a video that I could IM to people, a video that showed this is a future product. This is the future of MailChimp right here. It doesn't show the interface, doesn't show the UI. It shows people trying to solve problems in their workday. It just shows the work experience. So we didn't have to, you know, spend a lot of time comping up different UIs. I love when stories have a URL, because if it has a URL, it's easy to share that with someone else in your team. It's easy for everyone to be moving in the same direction, that they have a beacon on the hill to say, like, this is what I'm trying to make. It's memorable. I can revisit that. And that's a big thing. It's one thing to get the wisdom and create the strategy, but then you've got to communicate it to a lot of different people and get them moving in the same direction. And that's no easy task. So another thing that we do is every 2 weeks we send an email. And this responsibility goes to various people in the company. We trade it, you know, off and on. We call it the MailChimp Insights email, and it goes to the whole company. So whoever's studying something that's interesting, they learned something very valuable, or maybe they're just trolling through the database and find something that they want to share, they compose an email, they, you know, make some nice charts, some stats that can help people understand a subject very quickly. They send it out to the company. So we have this regular habit of contributing the data, but also mining the data and taking things out and changing that into a story. So we get, again, this ambient learning opportunity. I didn't have to go look for this information. It just came to me. It dropped in my inbox. That creates conversations at lunch, at the espresso machine, you know, if you're on the treadmill or something like that. People start chatting about these things. And that leads to projects and ideas and things that we could do together to make better experiences. Here's the real power, though. The thing that got me so excited about connecting all of this stuff together and connecting these people. I was talking to Steven Martin. He's a designer in the mobile team. He makes mobile apps. And he is a thoughtful guy, thoughtful designer, always wanting to make designs that are a little bit better and a little bit smarter. But if you're a designer, you know that it often feels like you're at the mercy of waiting for someone to give you the right information that can help you make a better design. So one day, Steven, this summer, was working on a new mobile app, MailChimp Mobile, and he wondered, okay, I'm going to create this new view for the report screen, but I'm not quite sure what information is really critical to people. How do they measure success? What do people say this is the most important thing? So he went into our little database and searched, you know, modified it, did some, you know, fancy searching where he used some operators to exclude certain terms, and he stumbled upon a screenshot from our survey that we ran at the beginning of the year, where we said, how do you measure success? What stats are most important to you after you send an email campaign? And it just ranked it. It was just a chart. In fact, you can see the chart taped up on the wall right behind his head in black and white. So he could see empirically, this is the stuff that's most important. Then he used our massive printer, and he made sort of the equivalent of an eye chart. This is the hierarchy of information of what people care about the most when sending emails. After they send it, what do they need to look at to say, this was good, this was bad? And he put that up there as a reference point, not just for him, but for the other people he's working with. Turns out that's also valuable for the web app team who sits right there in the same space when they're designing new views for reports. He answered his own question. He was empowered to answer his own question. He didn't come to me and say, hey, Aarron, can I commission a big study for you guys to go talk to a bunch of customers and ask how they measure success? He just looked on his own. And in doing so, he became a smarter designer, which is great. I mean, that's ultimately what we want. We want people to be empowered. We want people to be smart about what they're doing, to be able to design and stop decorating. So much of design often goes in that direction where, you know, you're just adding treatments to stuff that someone hands you, content, whatever that is. They're just decorating, you know, and that's a terrible place to be. I've been in that place myself. It just feels like, is this meaningful stuff? But when you know exactly what's going to help someone, you can make smarter decisions. So designers go from decorators and they become problem solvers. And that makes getting up in the morning to go to work feel a little bit better, right? It feels like you're doing something that's meaningful. So you filter this information. You can quantify that information. You take all of this qualitative information. It can be, to some degree, quantified, not entirely so. That's still a very difficult thing to do. We're trying to figure that out. But when you can quantify things, you can start to make decisions. This is worth our time. This is not worth our time. And that is how you turn data into wisdom. You go up that hierarchy, that pyramid. So we found that, you know, these silos of people, silos of data that divide us, and we're not, you know, the only ones. And we don't have political situations. We don't have difficult conflicts between departments. We're still small-ish. But I see so many companies that I talk to that are divided by teams, the teams that control the data, and what's going to happen with that. What we really need to do is just break that stuff down. Break down those walls between the teams. Break down the walls between the data and start connecting these different pieces to find patterns and to find meaning. We've got so much information that we're leaving on the table. We forget, you know, if you're working in a design research team, you have a design research team at the place where you work, we forget to look at analytics. We forget to look at, you know, tweets and blog comments and all of this different information that could be valuable. What could you mine from your databases that's already there with a cron job or something? How could you script in information about what's going on in the industry? How could you tie all this stuff together and find a pattern that you couldn't see before? Because chances are all of us here have something that we're missing. It's right in front of our nose. Connecting data is a really important thing to make companies smarter, but it's also an important thing to make companies just work better. You connect these teams together. When you connect data, you connect people. When you connect people, they can collaborate, they can make things, make better things in a better way. And that's what we're all excited about. That's what we're all motivated by. The coolest thing about this idea of connected UX, which I think is actually maybe a too small a term to describe what the possibilities here. You know, it's a connected company. What Dave Gray wrote about in his book by that title, The Connected Company. When people can ask crazy questions and know that they can get an answer, guess what they do? They ask more crazy questions, and they get more answers. And they solve problems faster, and they make smarter designs. And you can serve customers better. You create a culture of inquiry where lots of questions can be asked, a culture of learning. And I think that is so invaluable, not just for user experience teams, but for all teams and all companies that are trying to serve a big audience. Thank you so much for your time, guys. I think I've got a few minutes for questions here.
Thanks so much, Aarron. So yeah. We've got time for a couple of questions. Please stick your hand up if you had a question for Aarron. I'm going to run around with some microphones. Yep, there's one just down the front here.
Right here.
Hi, yeah. Is that on? Yeah, okay. Hi, I was just wondering if when you were implementing this process, if you came up against any barriers in, like, you know, who will design this system of information, and who will be the gatekeeper of this information? Yeah. Did you encounter anything, like any major points of pain when you were doing that?
So we did initially when we were trying different types of apps, where it was like, you know, this person is going to be the controller of that. And initially that was just, you know, practicality of, you're going to be the person that can tell me, like, what did you do? How are we doing here? You know, it's just kind of a practicality of how you manage your team. But that quickly started to fall apart because even the small things where it's like, oh, well, that's this person's project, so I can't really contribute. It's like this subliminal message that prevents people from contributing. So, you know, I mentioned I like to do it the MacGyver way, and Evernote is just the MacGyver way. It's like, I don't have to ask anybody about this. I don't really have to explain how to use consumer software that so many people are already using. It was just like, all this stuff is over here. I would love for you to participate. And what I failed to mention was in that insights email, it concludes with an invitation to join this account and start contributing, that you're welcome. So the message is always, come on in, you know, the water's fine, you can dig in here. So in our first few failed attempts, yeah, there was some limitations, but because we're relatively smallish still as a company and we have a lot of autonomy, it's not like I had to go through a lot of bureaucracy. I have talked to some different companies, different organizations that are trying to do this. The UK Prime Minister's Office, like the Cabinet and stuff, they're trying to do this too. They were using WordPress, they had some limitations, and now they're trying to do this with Evernote as well, because you know they've seen how this worked. I talked to some other folks, SoundCloud, mail.ru, they're trying to do the same things because, you know, there are a lot of companies, mid to big, that just, they've got this information, they don't know how to connect it together. And some people have said, like, we have security limitations, we can't go dumping everything in there. Pretty much all the stuff that's in here is like customer feedback, and do you gain anything, you know, is there any compromise if that stuff is, if someone gets into that? Not really, you know, it's not like you would get the keys to the kingdom or anything. So we're not putting anything in there that's super secret. So generally speaking, it's just the faster you can do it and, you know, asking for forgiveness instead of permission sometimes is a good policy. Anybody else? Got someone over here. Oh, someone up here. Yeah.
Sounds like you've got information coming from every corner that you possibly can get it from. At what point did you draw the line and decide, no, that information?
Yeah. We just kind of go based on gut. We all have a shared understanding that, you know, junk in, junk out. When it starts to be, you know, the streams, if they're not useful, they are controlled streams. It's not just arbitrary. So I started to see some of the tweets that were coming in being archived, and it's like someone with a, you know, like a MailChimp t-shirt on, a photo or something like that. And I was like, okay, cool, but I can't learn anything from that. I get a warm fuzzy, but that's not of any value. So we said, let's push that stuff out. And we explained that a little bit further. But for the most part, especially the main contributors, these different, you know, factions or different groups and teams, they know the type of stuff that's really valuable. So they know what to contribute and what not to.
We might have to leave it there because we're coming up to lunchtime. So any further questions, come up and speak to Aarron. So please join me in thanking Aarron Walter.
Thanks, guys.